gets respite mainly due to the fact that it tries to promote and protect human wisdom. No doubt, law itself is our best output of man's intelligence. At the same time, law itself is only tool to protect and preserve human wisdom through the process of intellectual property rights to preserve and promote human knowledge. Today, SDM Law College and Postgraduate Studies in Law and Karnataka Institute for Law and Parliamentary Reforms, KILPA, are making
Shankaratanaya Baruni Begadi Pankajalochana Toruni Dayadi.
Now I request my senior colleague, Mr. Vidyashankar, to
inaugurate the workshop. We have with us Honorable Mr. Justice Pulavadi G. Ramesh, Judge High Court of Karnataka. Honorable Mr. Pulavadi G. Ramesh practiced in the courts at Mysore and Bangalore, joined Karnataka Judicial Service as District Judge on 2-2-1993 and promoted to the cadre of District Judge Super Time Scale on 23-6-2000. Appointed as an additional judge of the Karnataka High Court on 8 September 2003 and as a permanent judge on 24 September 2004. On behalf of Karnataka Institute for Law and Parliamentary Reform, KILPAR, Bangalore, and Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatheshwara Law College and Center for Postgraduate Studies in Law, Mangalore, on behalf of Honorable Presiding Officers, invitees, delegates, students, and everyone present here, I respectfully welcome Honorable Mr. Justice Pulavadi G. Ramesh to this function. I request Dr. B.K. Ravindra, Director Principal of our college, to honor the Honorable Judge. We have with us orator par excellence, educationist, distinguished physician, eminent doctor, avid writer, Dr. B.M. Hegde, MD, FRCP, FRCPE, FRCPG, FRCPI, FACC, FAMS as president of the function. Dr. B.M. Hegde needs no introduction. Introducing Dr. B.M. Hegde is like holding candle to the sun. He is a walking encyclopedia. Dr. B.M. Hegde is presently the chairman of State Health Society, Government of Bihar, India, visiting professor cardiology at the Middlesex Hospital Medical School, University of London, professor of human health, Northern Colorado University, visiting professor, Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla, a former vice chancellor of Manipal Academy of Higher Education, a deemed university. Professor Hegde regularly gives talks on All India Radio, Doordarshan, BBC London. He has received several awards. The important are Pride of India Award from Federation of Indian Associations of Northern California, Dr. B.C. Rai National Award in the category of Eminent Medical Teacher, Jagadish Chandra Bose Award in Life Sciences, Distinguished Physician of India, Great Teacher Award, Gandhi Foundation Gujarat Award. He has held several positions which include Director of BG Studies, Professor and Head of the Department of Medicine, Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, Dean, Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, Principal, Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, Pro Vice Chancellor, Manipal Academy of Higher Education, a deemed university, Vice Chancellor, Manipal Academy of Higher Education, a deemed university. He has several distinctions to his credit. Continues to work as examiner for MRCP since 1988. Seems to be rare for Indians to attain that eminence. Fellow of Royal Colleges of Physicians, probably the only Indian to become the fellow of all the Royal Colleges of Physicians of the British Isles, including Ireland. Visited almost all the countries in the world as a visiting professor, examiner, a distinguished doctor, and academician, guided number of students from many universities for their doctoral thesis, including PhD. Visiting professor of cardiology in the London University since 1982. Professor of Human Health, College of Human Health Sciences, University of Northern Colorado, Elected Fellow, National Academy of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, Elected Fellow, New York Academy of Science. Dr. Mr. Hegde has published more than 35 books and has written 289 research papers and got it published in English periodicals, published from UK, USA, Germany, India, China, and Kuwait. On behalf of Kilpar and SDM Law College and Center for Postgraduate Studies in Law and everyone present here, I heartily welcome Dr. B.M. Hegde to this function. I request Dr. V.K. Ravindra, Principal and Director of our institution, to garland and present a memento to Dr. B.M. Hegde as a token of our respect and affection. We have with us Dr. B.K. Ravindra, Principal Director of our institution. Dr. B.K. Ravindra has been a guiding force in all our endeavors. I extend a warm welcome to Dr. B.K. Ravindra. On behalf of Kalpar, Bangalore and SDM Law College and PG Center in Law, I welcome Srimati Vijayalakshmi, an official of Kilpar, Bangalore, Dr. Devraj, Principal, Director, SDM, BBM and Postgraduate Studies in Management, Mangalore, the presiding officers of the various courts of Mangalore, invitees, my colleagues, student delegates and our press and media friends and all gathered here to make the workshop a meaningful one. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Sri Vidya Shankar. Now, light is no doubt symbol of wisdom, and light is also represent justice. To inaugurate this workshop, we have none other than Justice of High Court of Karnataka,
Honorable Justice of the Karnataka High Court, Justice Hulwadi Ramesh, my good friend, your director, Ravindra, judges from our Chief Judicial Magistrate is here, and all my old friends are here, media persons, and the future leaders of India. Because 97% of the MPs are lawyers. So I should respect all of you. Now, lest there should be any misconception, let me clear the air. It is not because of my busy schedule. I am just a stepney here. Last minute, they wanted me. So I had to be here. And I have got some other commitment actually it was at 10 o'clock, but I can extend it a little. So please pardon me. Justice has been so kind to permit me to speak first. And it's also in another way good because probably this is a subject about which I know very little. I could say I know little, not very little, little, nothing. But I was wondering as to how I fit into this. Madhuveli karadi vandagago. I do fit in a way that I probably know a lot about the ethical aspects of intellectual property rights. You all know the legal aspects of it. Actually, it all started with a justice, in fact. 1857. Up until then, people never even knew anything about the intellectual property rights. In one of the lower courts in America, he gave a judgment, I quote, he said, everyone has a right for his intellectual creations, just as he has on his physical possessions, the intangible things. And he actually wrote, just as he has right on the wheat he produces. This is where our problem started. And when the problems start, they keep on mounting because there is a big business behind it. Let me tell you this. I'll give you an example. How I wish intellectual property rights were there from the beginning of mankind. We would have nothing today. If all the scientists in the past had patented their thoughts, probably the world wouldn't have been where it is today. Let's say Einstein had patented E is equal to mc squared. It would have been good because it has been proved wrong now. But what I'm saying is, supposing Thomas Alva Edison had patented his bulb, you wouldn't have light yet. Did you know that? Supposing the Bell brothers had patented their aircraft, you wouldn't be flying. So this kind of things are there. I'll tell you the flip side of it. I said ethics. Do you know why? Anything that is ethically right is perforce legally right. But anything which is legally right need not be ethically right. In fact, law, I shouldn't be saying this, true. All, except me, all are There was a king in France. His name was King Ferdinand. And the year was just an year after Christopher Columbus discovered America, the so-called New World. He thought it was India. That was a misconception. So he called the local people as Amerindians, who are called the Red Indians now. Anyway, lot of poor people in Europe, unwanted people in Europe, were migrating to the New World in search of greener pastures. Okay? Now this king was a wise man. He made a statue. He said, no man, mark my words, the ladies were not supposed to be educated those days, no man who has studied jurisprudence shall be included in the group. Let people be happy in the New World at least. So the whole thing started in 1857. Up until that time, people knew there is something called intellectual property. Now you have an intangible thing, your thought. But do you know who that thought belongs to? It doesn't belong to you. It belongs to an energy. Human body is all energy. The whole world is energy. Did you know that? And what we know is just 5% of energy. All these laws that we talk about, all science that you talk about, all these big things that we talk about is 5%. And we thought that was 100% till very recently, till the electronic telescope called the Hubble's telescope came on the scene. When they looked deep into the galaxies and the planets, they found that there is more energy in between the planets than what is inside the planets. Very interesting. 95% of the energy is what you don't know, which we call as dark energy, dark matter, and subtle energy, and what have you. All these are confusing terms, but let me tell you this, that what we know, what we see, what we feel, and what we do is 5% of this universe. See, 30% of the matter that you don't touch is called dark matter, which is there in between the galaxies and the planets. The whole planets, galaxies, human beings, and everything on this earth, including the industries, the money, the intellectual property right, comes to 5%. So everything that you think, each time you think, hell of a lot of energy gets exchanged between the universe, the subtle energy universe, and you. And so it doesn't belong to you. It so happens that you are just there at that time. There's a beautiful thing in the Gita, nimitta matram. You are just an excuse. What happens, happens. So if, supposing I thought of something now, which I claim as my intellectual property right, it belongs to the whole universe. I'll give you an example of the flip side, of the unethical side of the intellectual property rights. Many of you must have heard of, you know, today in the paper everywhere, because this is the claptrap, the cacophony of advertisement. What do you see? Everybody who gets a chest, who has a chest, and if he has a pain or not, he is having an angiogram if he goes to the doctors. Next is, of course, an angioplasty, then, of course, a bypass. This angioplasty, we use a small little wire, which is like your, you know, fiber pinpoint ball pen. There's a tip of the similar one. It is also made of a little different metal, that's all, which we introduce in the vessel in the fond hope that the vessel will kept open, which is not true, but anyway, we do that. Now, the very fact that it is done and the patient has paid 3 lakhs of rupees, he gets relieved because it's what's called the placebo effect or the expectation effect. So now what happens is this can be manufactured at a cost of $10. How much? $10. when you or your parents get it, you pay $2,500. This is the flip side of patent right, intellectual property right. I can make that for $5 here, but if I make it, our young man from Bangalore will sue me and put me in jail. You see that? Now this is the flip side. I'm not going to the greater details. Everything is like that. You, today it has come to a ridiculous level. If I call something as something, you know, for example, if I write an article with a title, let's say I wrote an article the other day called Secrets of Healthy Living. Now people in America patent this also so that no one else can use that. If you look at the olden days, most great authors used to take these phrases from others for their titles. You know, Charles Dickens used to do that. Best of times, worst of times. It's not his patent, right? Someone else's. But he thought it's good. And actually Charles Dickens wrote, I quote, because I want to be more explicit in my expression. So you just quote. Today you can't, because a lot of these phrases are even being patented in America. They have gone to ridiculous levels. Now look at our farmers today. Monsanto has patented a seed which the government and the business want to push it onto our farmers. This is called a terminator seed, which is called a terminator gene. Supposing I buy that, taking a loan from the bank, and 1 year I may grow a good crop. Now I might be able to pay by my bank. I don't know whether it's true. But the next year I can't use that crop and the seed because it's terminator gene. It terminates there. Next year I have to again go to Monsanto and buy the seed. Imagine that. That is why a lot of farmers are committing suicide, because they don't know what to do. If our old rice that we had without any intellectual property, you grew it today, you didn't get much of it. Next year you can say same rice you can throw it in the nursery and you get the thing growing. But you can't do that. Now somebody has produced a potato with incorporating a gene from an Arctic virus which doesn't die in minus 100 degrees centigrade or plus 100 degrees centigrade. Now he has integrated that. So what happens? Today you can grow a potato here, and this potato can be thrown in the field itself for 100 days if the market is not good. When the market is good, you can sell it. You don't have to have a storage facility. You don't have the air conditioned thing. No expense at all. So you are told, it's very nice to grow that potato. But what you are not told is, there are two Solanaceae plants which are humanly edible. One is potato, another is sweet potato. And if any one of you know history, in the 30s depression, the whole of Europe lived because of potato. Now what happens? There are 498 species of Solanaceae fruits which are poisonous to human beings. Now we have introduced a gene from a germ onto this potato. Now what happens? There is what's called mutation of the gene next generation. I'll tell you how it happens. A lizard, have you seen a lizard? Not your home lizard, the big lizard outside. The lizard's enemy is snake in the forest. That's why the lizard is a chameleon. It can change its color to suit the color of the plant so that the snake doesn't find it. But the lizard has the capacity to smell the snake at a distance of 100 feet. So when the snake is at a distance of 100 feet, suppose the snake is in the director's room, the lizard here can smell it. You can't do that, right? But if the lizard is pregnant and the fetus is there, lizard says, I must protect my fetus in a better way. It can mutate its gene in such a way